When I was a little boy, I went one night with my parents late to the post office. They had some things they had to get in the mail. So I went with my pajamas with my mom and dad. When we got inside the post office, they went to the table and had a lot of letters and had to put stamps on it and addresses. I noticed a life-size cutout of Uncle Sam, pointed a finger, said, "I want you." And it was advertised in the Marine Corps. I was fascinated with the military as a little boy. My father was in the Navy, and he still had his dress blue uniform, and I loved to see that uniform in his closet. I noticed that they had little sign-up cards, so I took out a card for my parents for doing the mail, put my name David Cooper in my address, and dropped it in the box. Because I was interested. A few days later, I was at school and my mother was at home. The doorbell rang. She came to the doorbell, opened it up, and there stood a Marine staff sergeant in his dress blue uniform. She said, "May I help you?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Is David Cooper here?" She said, "No." He said, "Well, do you know when he'll be back home?" She said, "Well, he's at school now. He'll be back about 3:30. "Why do you ask?" He said, "Because he's enlisted for the Marine Corps and I've come to talk with him about his enlistment." She was stunned. She said, "Do you realize he's only 8 years old?" He was stunned. They both laughed about it, and he said, "Would you mind if I came back and picked him up Saturday and took him through the recruitment process?" She said, "I don't mind at all." And the next Saturday, Staff Sergeant Curtis C. Williamson showed up at my house in an official Marine car. I know his name because I continued to write to him for several years in elementary school when he was deployed, when we would write letters to the soldiers and send them gifts. And we spent all day that morning downtown Atlanta, took him to the recruiting station, showed me all the films they show the soldiers, and went through all the training. Got out a military combat rifle, showed me how to break it apart and put it back together, and then took me to lunch. Made a lifelong impression on me. I never did serve in the military. God had different plans for my life. But then I realized I was in a different army. Not a natural army, but a spiritual army. And all through the Bible, we read this imagery that Christians are engaged in spiritual warfare. There are natural wars being fought, but there are also spiritual wars being fought in the world as well. You know, when Jesus first talked about the church, the only time the word church appears in the four Gospels, Jesus used it toward the end of his ministry. He used it in a militaristic sense. In Matthew 16, verse 18, he said, "Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." He let us know that the church would do its work in the world faced with great opposition of a spiritual battle. Paul the Apostle often uses imagery. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 18, he said, "Fight the good fight of faith and take hold of eternal life." In 2 Timothy 2, verse 3, he said, "Endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." His last words were 2 Timothy 4, 7, "I have fought a good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith." Even Jude tells us in his brief letter, Jude verse 3, "Earnestly contend," that means fight, "contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to God's people." You and I are soldiers in a spiritual war. And that's why the challenge to us to stand in that conflict is so important. The Apostle Paul writes something so important for us to understand about spiritual warfare and the challenge to stand. We find it in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 13. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand." That phrase, "when the day of evil comes," the New English Bible is translated this way: "when life is at its worst, Stand your ground. And after you've done everything, not some things, not a few things, after you've done everything, to still stand until you see the victory in that battle. My message this morning is entitled, Stand Your Ground. Whatever happens, he says, when life is at its worst, stand your ground. Turn to somebody and say, stand your ground. That's a challenge for us as we step into this year. We say, well, how can I stand through a battle? How can I fight those spiritual battles? Because they're going on around us. Christians are being persecuted today at an alarming rate. We find ourselves engaged in a great spiritual war. Even in our own culture, there's an intellectual persecution where if you claim to be a Christian or you believe the truths of the Bible, you're ridiculed or regarded as unlearned or uneducated or naive. We find even that kind sometimes of undermining of our faith and people of faith. Then we go through personal battles in our own lives, sometimes in our families, in our marriage. A lot of the conflicts that you and I go through, the struggles, they're not just all natural. There are spiritual forces at work against us as well. We have to begin to look at some of our struggles in life as more than just circumstances, that there are spiritual forces of evil at work in the world. How can you and I stand through that? Stand to the point that we see victory in every battle. Well, Paul tells us there are four things we need to do if we're going to stand our ground. First of all, he says you've got to be able to stand. Look at this first truth. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. You can't stand if you're not strong. Our ability to stand is based on our strength in the battle. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 24, verse 10, if you falter in times of trouble, how small is your strength? It's not the greatness of the problems, and some of them are great, overwhelming at times, of the battles that you and I go through. It's not the greatness of the problem that ultimately defeats us, that makes us feel hopeless. We give up our faith. We quit fighting. It's because we don't have the strength it takes to stand. The most important thing that we do is to be strong in the Lord. I believe in physical health. I think we should take care of ourselves. I think we should have a healthy diet. We should exercise. And once we start the new year, many people set new goals for what they're going to do for their health. And that is so important. But I'm going to tell you, your spiritual health is far more important than your physical health. We need to keep ourselves spiritually strong. That ought to be on the priority number one as we step into this new year, that I'm going to keep myself spiritually strong through this year so that I can face every battle that's going to come my way. You know, when Joshua is about to prepare for battle, that was the first thing God told him in Joshua 1 verse 9, be strong and courageous. You see, you can't fight if you're not strong enough for the battle. Paul told Timothy in his ministry in 2 Timothy 2:1, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. John the Apostle wrote to the young people of the church in 1 John 2 and 14. He said, I write to you young men and women because you are strong and the word of God lives in you and you've overcome the evil one. But you and I can't overcome the evil one unless we're strong. One of the most well-known scriptures in the Bible is Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And sometimes we put the emphasis on I can. And we like to say, I can. We like to encourage people to say, I can. And I like that. I don't like the word can't. I think that's one word you got to get out of your vocabulary if you're going to be a winner in life, is the word can't. But the emphasis is not on I can, that we just kind of give ourselves a pep talk, build ourselves up on what we can do. The emphasis is on what he says, through Christ, through my relationship to the Lord Jesus, who strengthens me. It is only out of our relationship to the Lord that we derive the strength we need to stand in the middle of these battles. You say, if you get to the end of this passage, he shows you the key to that strength. The very end of this passage on spiritual warfare is verse 18. He says, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. And with this in mind, be alert. And keep on praying for all the saints. It is in that prayer time with the Lord that you and I are strengthened by the Holy Spirit. When you're going through a battle or you're facing problems, it's easy sometimes to run away from God instead of running to God. Sometimes life hurts so bad and we're confused. We don't know why this is happening to us. It's easy to get so discouraged that we don't turn to the Lord, and that makes us weaker. That's why we have a place to run to Him and to call upon Him. And in that time of communion with God, you will feel strong on the inside. God will impart such power and strength, strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. That's why we come together for worship on the Lord's Day. And we meet together in groups to pray for one another. You can't make it through a battle by yourself. One of the reasons that we're taught in Scripture that we need to gather for worship is to encourage one another. The word encourage doesn't mean to give somebody a pep talk, say, hey, you're gonna make it through it. The word encourage means to impart strength into someone else, to minister to them in such a way that you impart the power of God into their life so that they can stand. You can't stand if you're not able to stand. You can't stand if you're not strong enough on the inside to stand. Be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. There's something fascinating that happened in the life of Jesus that teaches us the importance of prayer and communing with God when you're facing a battle. The greatest battle that Jesus fought was on the cross. It was there that He defeated the demonic powers of this world and brought redemption for humanity. In fact, when Paul describes the cross in his writings, he describes it as a spiritual battle. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 and 15, he says that Jesus disarmed the powers and authorities, triumphing over them by the cross. The cross was the ultimate victory of God for the salvation of humanity. And how did Jesus prepare Himself for that battle? I've often asked, how did He get through that? Just looking at the humanity of our Lord, where did He find the strength to take that interrogation? Where did He find the strength to take the Roman scourge? Where did He find the strength to endure the crown of thorns? Where did He find the strength to have the nails driven into His hands and feet? We find the secret to His power. He could have ended that on any moment. He could have called the power of God into the situation. He could have given an explanation for Himself to Pilate, who was looking for a reason to exonerate Him. But He went through that battle. He suffered judgment in our place that we might be free from sin forever. Where did He find the strength? It's found in a little small story. Where did He go before He went to the cross? He went to the Garden of Gethsemane after the Last Supper. And what did He do there? He prayed. In fact, He went there to pray. That was where He was gonna gain the strength for that battle. He told His disciples to pray, didn't He? Watch and pray so that you do not fall into temptation. Watch and pray, be alert, be aware of what's about to happen here, and pray so that you won't be defeated by this, so that you don't fall into temptation. And He went and He prayed. And what did He pray? Father, not my will, but Yours be done. And He went back and He prayed it again. And He prayed the same prayer again. Now these people that tell you, just pray for it one time and move on, don't understand anything about prayer. Prayer is a place where God does a great work in your life. Prayer is a place where you stay until you have the power of God in your life. Prayer is a place that God ministers power in the hearts and the lives of His people. You don't stop praying until you've prayed through that situation and God has ministered His grace and power in your life. You keep going back like Jesus did and praying the same thing until you have a breakthrough with God and until you have the power of God that is deposited in your soul that's gonna give you the strength to stand through that battle. And that's how He got through the cross that day. And when He finished praying, what happened to Him? Luke tells us something extraordinary. In Luke 22, verse 43, after He prayed, then an angel from heaven came and strengthened Him. Isn't that fascinating? An angel came and strengthened Him. Stay long enough in prayer until God, by His grace, reaches down His hand and touches you with such power and such force and such strength that it drives all the fear out of your heart, all the hopelessness, all of the depression, and you rise up with the strength of a warrior and say, in Jesus' name, I'm gonna stand, and after I have done everything, I will stand. So to win a battle, you have to be ready for it. You have to be able to stand through the power of God at work in our lives, but you have to be armed. The second thing he says is put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Can you imagine military going into combat without armor? The physical armor they have, the body armor. And you know, most of the armor that a soldier has is for his protection, not for the attack. Most of it is for his defense, not for the offense. And most of your spiritual battles are going to be won, first of all, if you're able to defend yourself and hold your faith and not be defeated by what the battle you're facing really is. Even the trucks they drive, the tanks, everything is armored because the armor, the protection is crucial to victory. Put on the full armor of God. Don't put some of it on. Don't put on the easy parts. Put on the full armor of God. This is why people have to be in tremendous physical conditioning to serve in the military. The body armor that they wear in combat can be 50 pounds or more in excess. Just wearing the armor itself demands tremendous conditioning. And so it is with spiritual warfare. When he says put it on, this is a military command, the way this is written in his original letter. It means to put it on with a sense of immediacy and a sense of urgency. Don't leave yourself unprotected. Don't leave yourself unprepared for the day of battle. It also means to put it on and keep it on. Don't put it on and then take it off. Don't put it on Sunday and then take it off on Monday. Put it on and keep it on. Turn to somebody and say, put it on and keep it on. The armor of God. You have to be armed in order to fight a battle, in order to stand. The Benghazi tragedy that happened when we lost four Americans has been investigated in many respects as to what happened. And one of the things that happened was confusion. The military in Benghazi was given reports from the State Department. They were told to arm themselves for battle, to prepare. And then they got a call back and said, no, take the armor off. Then they got another call, no, put it back on. That's the last thing we need to be doing spiritually. We need to be armed and keep it on, because on any given day, you and I can face an intense spiritual battle. Now, what kind of armor should we have? Well, he goes on to tell us what the armor is. And when you read this description of the armor of God, it gives us six qualities of character, of life, that enables us to stand in any battle. He says in verse 14 through 17, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. You have to have on the belt of truth to stand. You've got to know that there is truth, and you've got to live your life by truth, because spiritual warfare is about lies and deception. The Bible tells us that we are to live our lives by the truth. We're living in a generation, and our young people, our children, are the greatest victims of this whole spirit. There is no absolute truth. There are no absolute right and wrong. We know that there is absolute truth that comes from God. And we need to tell our children that God is a God of truth. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And the scripture, the word of God, is true for our lives. Jesus said in John 8, 31 and 32, if you continue in my word, then are you truly my disciples. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. He says, put on the breastplate of righteousness. You know, the great joy, the Christian experience, is that the moment we put our faith in Jesus and receive him as our Savior, our sin is taken away and we are declared righteous in God's sight. We at that point are the righteousness of God as a gift. But now that God has made us righteous, we have a new nature. We need to live out that righteousness. You say, well, what does it mean to live righteous? It simply means to do what is right in the eyes of God. That's all righteousness means. It means to do what is right in God's eyes. Even in a generation, in a culture that says there is no absolute right, there's no wrong. You just make that up, whatever you want to think about that. And yet the Bible tells us in Isaiah 5 verse 20, woe to those who call good evil and evil good. There's a difference between right and wrong, and God reveals it to us in his word. If we do what is right, things are going to work out right. If we do what is wrong, things are going to work out wrong in our lives. The Bible says in 1 John 3 verse 7, don't let anyone deceive you. He who does what is right is righteous. And then he says, you also need your feet fitted with a readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. Can you imagine soldiers going into combat without boots? The boots they wear are fortified. Even the boots have armor on them to give them a sure foundation to protect them. He says, everywhere you go, take the gospel of peace. Be ready to share the gospel of peace, not the gospel of church tradition, not the gospel of legalism, but the gospel of peace. Share the good news of Jesus everywhere you are, because people can have peace with God, they can live in peace with each other, and they can have peace within themselves if they experience the grace of the living God. The Bible tells us, Romans 10:15, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Jesus said in Matthew 5:9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Then he says, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. In the time that Paul wrote this, they had archers in battle. Now, I can't imagine being struck by an arrow, worth less by a flaming arrow. That would be an horrendous death on a battlefield. But he used to describe the devil's tactics against us. Take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. What does that mean? Satan's attacks, the forces of evil, are seeking to destroy your shield of faith, because his attacks are deception and doubt and discouragement. And the only thing that'll overcome all of that is your faith. The Bible says in Isaiah 7:9, if you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all. Once you give up your faith, once you question your faith, you're on the road to defeat. The Bible says in 1 John 5:4, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Then he says, take the helmet of salvation. Can you imagine going into combat without a helmet? And soldiers wear two helmets in combat, not just the one that they wear when you see them out or in a parade. There's another one that goes on top of it, a metal helmet, and it's very heavy. It's called a combat helmet to protect them in combat. What does it mean? It means to guard your mind, to be very careful about what's coming into your mind, what's coming into your soul, what's coming into your heart. Even Peter uses this analogy in 1 Peter 4:1, arm yourselves with the mind of Christ. And then he gives us our only offensive piece of weaponry, and take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. A sword, an offensive weapon to use in battle. That's the Scripture, the Word of God. Thank God for the Bible today, for the Old Testament of its 39 books, of the books of history and poetry, the books of prophecy. Thank God for the New Testament, the 27 letters we have, the beautiful four Gospels that show us the life of Jesus from four different angles, the actions of the early church inspired by the Spirit, all of those great apostolic letters to help us grow in grace, and the great apocalypse, the book of Revelation, that tells us in the end of this age, Jesus Christ is coming again. This year, as we move into this year, we need to be strong in the Scripture. That's what we need, is the Word of God. Keep yourself strong by reading the Word and listening to the Word and living the Word of God. It's a sword in your life that helps you win your spiritual battles. When you apply anything in Scripture in life, you're going to win that battle. When you apply Scripture to any battle in life, you're going to win that battle. The Scripture says in 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all Scripture is inspired of God and is useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, and training in righteousness, so that the man or woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That's why we commit ourselves to the Word of God, to get it in our hearts, to get it in our souls, so it shapes our lives, so that we can face the battles of life. You not only have to be ready for battle and be armed, you've got to be alert. You've got to be aware that there's a spiritual war going on. He says, put on the full armor of God. Why? So that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. The Bible is very clear that there's an alien presence in this world, an evil presence. He calls him Satan, which means accuser. He calls him the devil, which means your adversary or your enemy. It calls him the tempter. The Bible says that there are demonic spirits at work in the world as well. This word schemes, the devil's schemes, means strategies, tactics, devices that he has set against God's people. Even Paul refers to this in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 10 and 11. We are not ignorant of Satan's devices in order that he might not outwit us. Did you know there are strategies and tactics and schemes of the forces of evil that come against you and me to defeat us at every turn? And he goes on to describe this so that we are aware and on our guard that we're living in a spiritual war, not just natural wars in the world. There's a spiritual war going on. And sometimes the struggle you and I are going through is not just natural. There are spiritual forces at work behind the scenes. The Bible tells us in Revelation 12, verse 7, there's war in heaven. We hear every day about wars on earth, but there's also war in heaven. There's war in the heavenlies. In fact, he describes what's going on. Look at verse 12. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. That's a great revelation there, isn't it? Our struggles, not all of our struggles, are against natural forces, but against the rulers, against the authority. He's describing demonic powers at work in the world. Against the powers of this dark world. Did you know that that phrase in the Greek language of the New Testament refers to the influence of evil in politics? It refers to those people in powerful positions that unleash great evil on the world. That there are people in political positions in history that have at times been under such a demonic influence. That's why you see Adolf Hitler, Saddam Hussein. You still see them in the world today. Look at the genocide they commit. Look at the trail of blood behind them. Why is that there? Because they're inspired by demonic power. Even the Bible says in Revelation chapter 13 that the Antichrist will derive his power from the great dragon, a symbol in Revelation of the devil himself. Did you get that? The Antichrist derives his power from the great dragon. That there's a power sometimes upon evil. That's why you look at what they do and you think this is inhuman. Exactly right. It is human. That's why you can't comprehend it. It's demonic in nature. And you see the bloodshed behind these people because Jesus said in John 8 and 44, the devil is a murderer from the beginning. And there are forces of evil at times. The early church was persecuted by the Roman government. Naturally, it looked like a political force against them. It's not a political force. It's because Emperor Nero was demonically inspired. And that's why you see the horrible atrocities against the church. You and I are living in that same kind of world today. And Paul says you need to be aware and alert of what's really going on and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Think of the significance of that. Our struggle is against what? The spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. In the letter of Ephesians, Paul mentions the heavenly realms five times. What is that? That is the spiritual realm where these powers are at work. There's more going on in the world than just the natural. The worst thing to do in life is to not be aware of this. To get caught off guard by this, to think everything is just natural. And then we try to solve all of our problems by natural means instead of spiritual means. You can't fight a spiritual battle with natural weapons. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 and 5, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. He says, I want you to be aware of what's going on. Be alert. That's why Jesus told his disciples, watch and pray. You need to be aware of the spiritual forces of evil that'll come against you and against your family and against the church in the last days. When we were attacked at Pearl Harbor and experienced such a horrible loss of life, and you can visit Pearl Harbor today and you can see the wreckage of that great attack. Why did that happen? Because we weren't ready. We weren't alert. We never expected that attack. That's why it happened. We weren't aware. We were not on high alert. When 9/11 happened and a handful of terrorists flew airplanes and took down the World Trade Center, almost got completely to the Pentagon and another location, were not for the heroes on the board of those planes, they would have done tremendous damage that far exceeded what they did. Did you know that a great number of the terrorists that attacked us were on an FBI watch list at the time we were attacked? Apparently, they weren't being watched so closely. That's why Jesus said, watch and pray. Your marriage is going to be attacked. Your life is going to be attacked. Your dreams are going to be attacked. The church is going to be attacked. He says, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes, to be on your guard. We are living in a great spiritual war, and we're only going to be able to fight that war if we can stand our ground, if we can be strong enough, be able to stand, be armed for the day of battle, and be aware of what is going on in this world. But then he tells us one final challenge. You need to be aggressive. When it comes to fighting your battles, you need to be aggressive. You don't need to be weak. You don't need to be fearful. You need to, when you're going into a spiritual battle in your life or your family, for your health, you need to fight until you win. You need the spirit of a fighter, the spirit of a warrior. And don't allow discouragement and hopelessness and depression rob you of that amazing quality to say, I'm going to fight the good fight of the faith. And some of you are living today through a season. It's a struggle. It's a fight, yes, but it is a battle that can be won. It is a victory that can be achieved. And the key is stand your ground. Over and over, he says, stand. Now, this challenge to stand means two things. First of all, it means to hold the line. Everybody say, hold the line. Don't surrender one inch of territory to the enemy. Don't allow him to take anything from you that you've gained and you've accomplished. But it also means to aggressively attack the enemy, to go on the offensive. When you're having problems, don't be passive. When you're going through struggles, don't give up and say, I don't know how we're ever going to get through this. No, take on the attitude of a fighter that says, we're going to put on the armor of God. We're going to go through this battle. We're going to live by the word. We're going to trust God, and we're going to come through this battle with great victory. Stand, hold the line, and aggressively attack whatever enemy is coming against you. I preached in Pennsylvania one time, and David Paul went with me. We had the opportunity to go and tour the battlefield at Gettysburg. That was the battle in the Civil War that really began to turn the war for the victory of the Union force. The Confederates had marched all the way north. If they had conquered, they had won at Gettysburg, they would have then marched on Washington, D.C. and taken over the Capitol. It was the most strategic battle in the Civil War. And they arrived there, and the Union forces weren't ready. They met them first with a small force, and they lost the first day, the Union did. It took them all night long to get reinforcements in, and the Confederates were going up to the high ground. If they got the high ground, they would win that battle. They went up a side, and you can visit it this day. It's called Little Round Top on the edge of that mountain. That was the most strategic part of the three-day battle that ensued. It cost thousands of lives. That little battle on Round Top was the most strategic battle of Gettysburg early on in that 3 days of conflict. The Confederates routed around that mountain to get to that high ground. There was a small group of the 20th Maine Division, volunteer infantrymen, 386 men. They had some reinforcements. That's all they had there. And they were grossly outmatched by the Confederates coming up that hillside. Colonel Chamberlain is one of the most recognized colonels of the Civil War. He had very little military experience. He didn't get in the war until the second year. He was a school teacher, but he wanted to volunteer his services. He was the colonel. And those men wanted to retreat from that attack from those Confederates. He stood there, and he had one challenge. You hold this line at all costs. You hold this ground at all costs. You don't surrender one inch of territory, no matter how frightened we are, how outnumbered we're. That was the only challenge. You hold this line at all costs. They fought the battle race. The Union was almost out of ammunition, so they thought they would then retreat. You know what he did? He ordered a bayonet attack. He said, you put your bayonet on your rifle and aggressively attack the enemy, grossly outnumbered, almost out of ammunition. Do you retreat? No. You use everything you have. You stand, and after you've done everything, to stand. He said, we still have bayonets, and they put the bayonets on, and they charge down that hillside, and their aggressive attack of the Confederates, even though they outnumbered them, so overwhelmed them and terrified them, the Confederates turned and retreated, and they won a great victory, and they kept the Confederates from ever taking that high ground. And it was a strategic move that eventually won the victory. Now, you're going to face things in your life that you're outnumbered for. You're going to feel like your problems are too big in your life, in your marriage, in your family, with your kids, with some addiction, with financial problems, with health issues, with spiritual issues going on. It's easy to feel that way in the world today. Is our mission, is it too overwhelming? Can we make a difference in the world? Absolutely. Put on the full armor of God. Be strong in the Lord, in His mighty power. power and stand your ground. Whatever you do, hold that ground at all costs. And when you think you've done everything, put your bayonet on and attack the enemy, and you fight the good fight of faith until you win the victory that you desire. Praise the Lord. Everybody shout, stand your ground. Say it again, stand your ground. Now I want you to stand with me and take somebody's hand. We're going to pray a prayer of victory this morning for each other. Who can imagine, really, the battles that are being fought in this sanctuary right now? Who really can comprehend all that you and I are going through? So let's pray for each other. Let's impart strength to one another. Pray one for another, the Bible says. And let's go to the Lord in this prayer of victory. Before I pray that prayer, I'm going to give any person here, anybody watching me, an opportunity who's not yet trusted the Lord Jesus as your Savior. Your whole life can change today. You can begin to live the life that God has for you. That's why Jesus came into this world, that we might have life and have it more abundantly. The greatest decision you'll ever make is when you receive Him as your Savior and begin to follow Him with your life. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you shall be saved. You shall be saved. Let me lead you in prayer this morning. If you need the Lord as your Savior, pray this simple prayer from your heart. Lord Jesus, I do believe in you. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Lord, I confess my sins to you. I ask for your forgiveness. I receive your saving power and your saving grace to make me a new person today. Lord, I believe in you. I receive you now as my Savior. I declare Jesus is Lord of my life. I make my decision here and now, Lord, to give you all that I am, to serve you. Lord, I know from this moment on, I belong to you. Now let's pray for each other today. Allow the Holy Spirit to lead you as you pray for the person whose hand you hold. Lord, I thank you that with you all things are possible. We pray for one another today that the Holy Spirit will come upon us with such power, such strength, even as the angel of the Lord touched the Lord Jesus in Gethsemane and strengthened him. May your Spirit come upon every person today and strengthen them for battle. I pray that you'll drive out the fear, the feeling of hopelessness, the feeling that things can never change, that feeling of despair and despondency over a battle that has waged too long. I pray that you'll drive all of that out, that you'll inspire faith today, that we can take up the shield of faith today, that we can extinguish the flaming arrows of discouragement and doubt and deception that have come against us. Lord, we claim victory in Jesus' name, and we resolve today that we're going to stand through this battle. We're going to stand, and after we have done everything, we are going to stand. Hallelujah. It has been great to share this time of worship with you. The psalmist says, "This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." Sunday is the day that we gather to worship the Lord as we begin our week together. It's amazing to me how refreshed we are spiritually, what strength we gain when we come together to worship the Lord. I ask for your prayers for me and the pastoral staff and the entire ministry of our church, that we would continue to know and to do the will of God. I also appreciate the support that you give to the church as you're able to help the church with tithes and offerings as the Lord leads you. Finally, it is incumbent upon all of us to become evangelists. Now, I know sometimes that may feel intimidating for all of us. We might not even feel qualified to share our faith, but we are. We're all living witnesses of Jesus Christ. Take this worship service, the music, the prayers, the Word of God that is shared, and share them with your friends and those who need the Lord. Again, thank you for being a part of this great worship service today, and I pray God's richest blessings on you as you begin a new week.